Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear brothers and my sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. When you look at the world today, Muslim and non-Muslim, you see something really disturbing, and that is how both worlds treat women. We, as I said so many times, we tell the world that Islam came to give women their rights. Islam has come to liberate women and you know the story. But when it comes to reality and to the implementation, that's a completely different story. And I have said before that when a Muslim couple gets married, the man's main concern is to discuss with his woman, if there is that discussion, on how she should obey him. That she must obey him, because if she doesn't obey him, if she doesn't respond to his needs, if she doesn't work for him, then she has the great news that she is going to go to hellfire. Allah's curse is on her. The angels will curse her if she doesn't do what he tells her. What this does is it gives the man the upper hand to oppress and put the woman in a very, not only second-class citizen, but the 99th class citizen. The woman becomes just somebody in the shadows lurking. Then when she carries his babies, these kids are his. Some people don't even trust their women with their children, and they call them the children of the men. But what does Islam really say? Because this sickness here is not something new. It has gone and traveled with us for more than 13 centuries and a half. So where did it all start? Why are women mistreated today? Why are they being mistreated today? When we look in the books of the fuqaha, the scholars of Islam, the full scholar of thoughts, and everybody of them, for example, if I take the book of Ibn al-Jawzi, when he speaks about the woman in the fiqh, he says that the woman should consider, once she gets married to somebody, she is considered like a slave woman, and she must bear and be patient with her husband, just like slaves are patient with their masters. And that she should bear, and whatever he does, she should go along with it. This crooked understanding was and is and will continue to stay unless and until we fight it. For example, when the books of fiqh have been written before, if you could read some Arabic, you will pull your hair out of your head for what these scholars have said. Yes, they are honorable scholars, they are great scholars, they are pious, whatever it is. But if there is one part of the Muslim community that has been belittled and oppressed, that is women. Subhanallah, if a woman wants to get married, she becomes a slave to the man. How can we tell the world that Islam came to liberate women? When before you get married to somebody, you are free to do what you want. You can work, you can sleep, you can do what you want. And as soon as you get married, you have to obey him. You have to move from the freedom world into the obedience, or as I call it, slavery world. Is this what Islam came? Is this what really happened? Was this what our Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did as soon as he got married? His main concern is, you must obey me. Because if you don't obey me, Allah is going to curse you, the angels are going to curse you, and you are going to go to hellfire. This has created a low self-esteem women. Many women really feel depressed, stressed out. Is this what it all boils down to? Well, actually, what Islam says and what these scholars have done, really they have murdered the rights of women in Islam. It is common sense today, as soon as you open your mouth to challenge a saying of the scholars, the very first thing that they're going to tell you is the flesh of scholars is poisoned. You must not talk about them. Well, actually, this is not even a hadith. This is a saying of a scholar. This scholar is Ibn Asakir. But he said, "Luhum al-ulama masmuma." And the emphasis is on the ulama, the scholars, the real true scholars, not those university fabricated people of today, the seekers of knowledge. And what he means is, when a scholar, for example, like Ibn Taymiyyah or Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, or for example, like Ibn Baz or Ibn Uthaymin or Al-Albani, alayhi rahmatullah, these great true scholars that have not been produced by universities, when you speak against them, not against the knowledge that they, because they can make mistakes and you can debate these mistakes. But for example, if you speak about Sheikh Nasruddin al-Albani, instead of discussing the issue at knowledge level, you attack him in his person and you start speaking about his family, and that is what it is. Today, for example, in the Middle East, the moment you open your eyes to argue with a scholar to discuss a point, or you speak something against them, straight away they jump to your neck. The flesh of the scholars is poisoned. Well, actually, show me the scholars and I will not speak about them. Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah alayhi rahmatullah said something extremely important when he spoke about the scholars that do not deserve to be spoken against in their own honor. He said, but as for those who work for the government, whose purpose is to just feed their bellies and accumulate wealth, for those people who don't care much about the religion, but they care much about their wealth, these people are not considered scholars, and their flesh is not considered poisoned. But in any way, let's go. So let's go back in history. So as I said, in the early days of fiqh, the scholars, and for your information, Islam is a man's scholar. It all is. Hardly ever you hear the opinion of a woman, and especially that we know that there are so many female scholars. Hardly ever you hear them. And if they could take away the sayings of the Sahaba, the ladies, they would have. And that's because of the culture of the Arabs. Now, remember, when Al-Islam came, Quraysh used to bury the girls alive. Women used to be used and abused. That's what they were. And that stayed with the Arabs. It disappeared at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But as soon as he died sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as soon as the Sahaba died, the disease came back. Which religion says that women cannot drive? The other day I heard this fatwa on the internet in Saudi Arabia. What this person here says, that a girl or a woman cannot go on the internet by herself. She must have a mahram to go with her. This made the laughing stock of the world. Translated, and people are laughing to their teeth because of this idiotic fatwa. Let me tell you how as-sahabiyat were at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the companions, so you get a good idea of who you are, my sisters. You are not what your culture has made of. Your husband is not here to boss you. If his concern is that you obey him only, this guy has got a brain crooked like that of a squirrel, and you need to get it out of town, have a surgery on his brain and educate him. Look at what Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said in Sahih al-Bukhari. Kunna ma'ashar Quraysh naghribu al-nisa. We, the men of Quraysh, we used to have the upper hand on the women from Mecca. فَلَمَّا قَدِمْنَا عَلَى الْأَنْصَارِ. So when we arrived to Al-Madina, when they migrated to Al-Madina, إِذَا قَوْمْ تَغْلِبُهُمْ نِسَاؤُهُمْ. We found a people whose women or the ladies had the upper hand on men. So complete opposite of what was happening in Mecca. فَطَفِقَ نِسَاؤُنَا يَأْخُذْنَا مِنْ أَدَبْ نِسَاءِ الْأَنْصَارِ. So our women, i.e. of Mecca, started learning from the ladies of Al-Madina. قال, this is Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu speaking. فَصَخَبْتُ عَلَى مْرَأَتِي فَرَجَعَتْنِي. So one day Umar ibn al-Khattab yelled on his woman, on his wife. And she returned the words, she argued back. And that was a huge surprise to Umar. This woman, he knows her from Mecca. She was not like this. فأنكرت أن تراجعني. So I rebuked her, and I really was unhappy for her to respond back. قالت, she said, ولما تنكر أن أراجعك. Why are you all denying and angry that I return back my words to you? فوالله إن أزواج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يراجعنه. By Allah, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam argue back with him. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says something, they return back and they tell him back. They make him. They argue back. وَإِنَّ إِحْدَاهُنْ لَتَهْجُرُهُ الْيَوْمَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. And that one of them, she will abandon Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not talk to him, angry at him, from Salatul Fajr until night. Angry, or from when the argument starts until the end of the night. Umar ibn al-Khattab was even more surprised. He says, فَأَفْزَعَنِي ذَلِكَ. It scared me so much. And I said to her, قَدْ خَابَ مَنْ فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ مِنْهُنْ. He is a great loser and is a failure. Who of them, of the wives of Rasulullah ﷺ, that does that with him? Now pay attention. Man with Rasulullah ﷺ, they wouldn't dare look him up in the eyes. His women have arguments with Rasulullah ﷺ, disagreement with Rasulullah ﷺ, wouldn't talk to him from morning until night. Then what Umar said, ثُمَّ جَمَعَتُ عَلَيَّ ثِيَابِي. He pulled his clothes on him because he was in a hurry and in a total state of shock. فَدَخَلْتُ عَلَى حَفْصَةَ فَقُلْتُ لَهَا. He went to his daughter Hafsa, who is one of the wives of Rasulullah ﷺ, and he told her, أي حفصة, يا حفصة, أتخاضب إحدى كنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اليوم حتى الليل. Is one of you, تخاضب is angers Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and doesn't talk to him for the whole day until night time? She said, قالت نعم. She said, yes. Umar ibn al-Khattab was about to lose his mind. It's something unheard of. فقلت, he said, I said, قد خبت وخسرتي. You are miserable and you have failed and you are a loser. أفتأمنين أن يغضب الله لغضب رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم فتهلكي. Are you completely safe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't get angry for the anger of the Prophet and then Allah will punish you? And this is in Al-Bukhari. In Al-Bukhari. You never hear. Look at this hadith here and look at how the Muslim mentality is so sick today. So much so that a woman cannot argue back. She can't say a word. How about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? His wife for the whole day, they wouldn't talk to him. And just in another hadith also, as I said in Al-Bukhari, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says to Ummuna Aisha, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُ إِذَا كُنْتِ عَنِّي رَاضِيَ وَإِذَا كُنْتِ عَلَيَّ غَضْبًا. He tells her, يَا Aisha, I know when you are pleased with me and when you are angry with me. SubhanAllah, this is also in Al-Bukhari. قالت فقلت من أين تعرف ذلك. How do you know that? فقال, he said, أما إذا كنت عني راضية فإنك تقولين لا ورب محمد. When you are pleased with me and happy with me and everything is rosy, you says no by the رب, the Lord of Muhammad. وإذا كنت غضبة, if you are angry with me, قلتي لا ورب إبراهيم. She wouldn't even say his name, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She wouldn't even utter his name. She would name the father Ibrahim عليه السلام, the father of the prophets Ibrahim عليه السلام. قالت قلت أجل والله يا رسول الله. She said, I said, yes, والله you are right, يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. ما أهجر إلا اسمك. Meaning, I only don't like your name. Otherwise, in my heart, you're still my husband and I love you. But she just wouldn't say his name because she's angry at him. Compare this and how for 14 centuries of crooked fiqh that Muslim women today are 99th class citizens. They are not even second class citizens. Everything that a man knows, if there is one hadith that every man out there knows, is that women ناقصات دين وعقل. They lack and they are deficient in the deen and the aql. And they don't even understand it properly. Let me tell you this and I end up my talk here with this thing here. When was this hadith said? As in الصحيحين, البخاري المسلم, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said this on a Eid day, on a day of joy. Do you think on that day when Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said to the Sahabiyat, تصدقن, spend in sadaqah. Do you think on a Eid day where we are happy, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sat in his home And there were girls playing on the drums and singing. And Rasulullah was there listening to them and enjoying. Do you think on that great happy day, Rasulullah would go to the Sahaba, to the companions, to mess up that day and tell them, you in hellfire? When Rasulullah went to the Sahabiyya, to the companions, and he saw them all seated and chit-chatting, happy, it's Eid. It's a party day. It's a beautiful day. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, joked with them. And you know when Rasulullah jokes, he only jokes in truth. And then he said, Ma ra'aytu minkun, I have not seen of you women who are deficient in their deen and in the mind that would cause the wisest and the strongest of men to lose his marbles. This is a joke. The Sahabiyat radiallahu anhum went ahead and said, okay, since you, how are we deficient, Ya Rasulullah? Then he told them, when one of you has her menses and she doesn't pray for days or she doesn't fast for days, that is the lack in her deen. Here, what it means in the deen, does it mean in Islam as a whole? No, it doesn't mean that. It means only in the actions. Which means, sometimes, my dear sisters and my dear brothers, if a woman has 7 days menses and she doesn't pray in those 7 days, the quantity of the days she prays in a month is 23 days, 7 days she doesn't pray. That's where the lack is. It's not about the quality of her salat. Because there are women who only pray 3 weeks, but the reward they get far more than what a man prays in 6 months. It does not affect what's in your heart as the belief, my sister. It does not affect the quality of your act. It only affects the number. And here it doesn't hurt you at all. It doesn't hurt you at all. Let me put it in different words. Let's say you have five fruits. Their nutrition is extremely beautiful. And somebody else has got 10 fruits, but the nutritional values are not as good as your fives. The number here is absolutely irrelevant. This is what Rasulullah ﷺ, he was joking with the Sahabiyat. It was not an attack on them. It was on a Eid day. And then when he said about the deficiency in mind, he mentioned only one thing. That one thing is when it comes to business dealing in borrowing money. Not in sales, not in anything else. It's only in borrowing money. And the scholars have said the reason why a woman, we need 2 women for instead of 1 man. They say because men are used to going out. They are used to witnessing a lot of things. Women most of the time are home. And if you take 1 woman and she stays home for 4 or 5 months, she will forget because she is preoccupied by so many other things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained in Al-Quran that the purpose for 2 women is less that one of them forgets and the other one will remind her. How come a Muslim man takes now and makes every single woman out there when it was just a joke by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the Sahabiyat to show how magnificent and how extreme intelligent they are? It's like you go to somebody and you tell him he is the top student in the whole country, and you go and tell him, I have never seen a loser like you. You don't study and you don't write your notes, yet you are the top student in the country. So him not studying and not taking notes, is that an attack on him? Or are you telling him, what would you have done if you could write and you have studied? You'd be top of the world. That's exactly what the hadith is. It is not to belittle women. It is far more to show how high their status is in Islam. Unfortunately, the misunderstanding of this hadith has made people like Ibn al-Jawzi alayhi rahmatullah, and many of them, I don't want to mention names here, Zuhri alayhi rahmatullah, and many other scholars, and these are leaders of school of thoughts, they say when a woman gets married, she becomes like the property as a slave is owned by her master. And all the books of fiqh have been written with this sick thinking that women are less of a citizen in Islam than man. And then we go to the world and we tell the world that Islam came to liberate women. And as soon as the poor English lady or the American lady or the French lady comes into Islam, only to find out that she is deficient, that she is stupid, that she is ignorant, that she has to obey her husband, that she cannot say no. And if she says no, she's going to go to hellfire. What? She embraced Islam to go to hellfire? Are you observing the hijab to go to hellfire? Do you have to, every time your husband says, come here, let's have sex, if you say no, that you are cursed? This is the sick, manipulative, male understanding of Islam. Unfortunately, as I said, this misunderstanding rubbed on the culture. And today, the sickness of the Saudi people is rubbing on us. Their scholars, again, they are culturally motivated. And Saudi Arabia, as I said, spent money to propagate their own understanding, their madhab here in Europe. And you see a lot of people today, they feel extremely low. I remember many couples, they come and they complain the husband is abusive. Why? Because as soon as he guarantees that the woman is going to be his slave, what do you expect? No, my sister, Islam came to liberate you. Look at Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is very nice man. He's absolutely fantastic. Did he care about his own culture? He did not care at all. He treated women because he was a great man. Umar ibn Khattab was surprised because that's how he grew up in Quraysh. We want the Islam of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We want the man to be extremely comfortable in his skin so that when his wife tells him no, he doesn't lose it. Because what this means, my dear brothers and my sisters, is if you cannot stand that your woman debates with you or argues with you or gets angry with you, you have problems. You have emotional problems. You have this inferiority complex. And this is what the Muslims are. They do have a man. I'm talking an inferiority complex as much as soon as he marries a woman, he doesn't want to win her heart. Ya khi, subhanallah, if you win the heart of a woman, forget obedience. She'll be ready to give her life for you. It's sad that 95% and more of Muslim couples do not experience the true love, where your woman, out of love, she wakes up before you wake up to go to work, and she'll prepare the breakfast for you, and she comes to you with that beautiful smile on her face, because a woman is nurturing. When she finds the man, when she does these kind of things, it makes her world. It makes her world that she actually cares for a man who values her more than life itself. That's why the wives of Rasulullah ﷺ were ready to give their lives for him. And you today, you tell me, I want you to obey me? Hey, dude, what's wrong? Is the complex really killing you? And I can tell here so much, but what I'm saying here, my dear brothers and my sisters, we need to break this complex that has traveled with us for hundreds of years. When it comes to women, we must listen to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not the interpretation of the cultured sheikhs. And again, one last point here that I want to say, in Saudi Arabia specifically, in the Middle East generally, it's one culture rules all. It's just that even if scholars feel different, they cannot and they will not dare speak different. Because as soon as... Look, I'll tell you something. The head of the Da'wah Bureau in Mecca al-Mukarrama, Hayat al-Amr bil-Ma'ruf wal-Nahy an al-Munkar fi Mecca, the head of that bureau, his wife was on television and she was not wearing the niqab. The next day, the whole Saudi Arabia went upside down. And how doesn't he fear Allah? And why is he committing a major sin? Well, it's not a major sin. Niqab is not compulsory. But you see, that's who they are. And they made a big fuss out of it. And then he told them, hey, my wife removed. And this is the head of Maktab al-Da'wah, al-Amr al-Ma'ruf, Hayat al-Amr al-Ma'ruf al-Nahy al-Munkar in Mecca. And more and more. This is why now in Saudi Arabia, we have atheists that have started forming groups, and we have female activists now that are going against the school of thought, because they found out that actually Islam you need a mahram to go on the internet. Well, this is a joke. So my sisters, remember, You were born free. Al-Islam came to give you a better status. If your husband's disease and complex of inferiority is to make you obey him, you really need to question your marriage altogether. Why are you married to this gentleman here? This is your brother Abdus Salam Ibn Ammar, and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our eyes and give us a better status and help us be much better and much nicer to our wives. There are, alhamdulillah, some scholars now, and they are challenging this closed, narrow-minded thinking, and there is something happening. Perhaps maybe 10, 20 years, the status of Muslim women will be far more better than what it is today. To join my group, just send me a message with your name on 078-76-40-8735. Please do circulate this. We want to educate as many women as possible. We're sick and tired of the West looking at us with those eyes of, I feel sorry you are a Muslim. Just like they wrote one day an article that the worst place to be a woman at is Saudi Arabia. And we want to change that, and we want to show that Islam is what Rasulullah ﷺ did and said, not what Saudi Arabia says. وصلى الله على نبينا محمد سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.